Dragon Egg Empire isn't the only nation with an encounter card ride line, as Keter Sanctuary got its very own in the likes of Phantom Blaster Dragon. Acro Fighters, welcome back to another set review, and today we're going to tackle the third nation of the Brush with the Legend support set, as we're going to talk about the cards for Keter's Sanctuary. Now, of course, we can expect support for Bastion as well as for the Sorcerer's Hexaorb deck, but this nation, just like Dragon Empire, also got the new ride line with the new encounter card. So we're bound to see some spicy cards with Blessed Arc, Phantom Blessed Dragon, and all the support cards around it. So without any further ado, let's jump straight into these cards and see what Keter Sanctuary has in store for us for set 2 of Overdress. So first off, they've got of course the new front trigger in the likes of Bard of Heavenly Song L pack, which has the new improved skill Continuous on Guardian Circle. If your opponent Vanguard is great for your greater, this unit gets shield plus 5k. Just like all the other front triggers, it's going to be a solid 5-star card for me, as it's an improvement of the trigger that we already got, and the extra 5k shield helps a lot. Now, followed up, we've got a generic grade 1, which is actually really good in my opinion, which is Magic of Advancement Melkoko. And Melkoko has the ability Auto: when this unit is placed on the rearguard circle, cost Soulblast 1, draw a card, choose a card from your hand, and discard it. So it's basically a cycle effect, but in this case, it doesn't have any weird restrictions, or it doesn't retire itself, because you can basically see this as a different version of Painkiller Angel, as they both cost a soul, and they both basically cycle a card. But I like this more, because for one, it doesn't retire itself, so you still have her as an 8k booster on the field, and now you can discard maybe a unit that doesn't really do anything in your hand, like maybe too many Great Freeze, which is great, but more importantly, it's one of those rare cycle cards that first draw and then discard. So you have way more control over how much value you're going to get out of this skill, which is great, because at the very least, you can always discard the card that you just draw if it doesn't help you in the slightest with any of your strategies that you were going for. So for me, this is going to be a solid 3-star card, as it's a really good cycle card, but besides that, it's still just a generic cycle card. Now, a great one that I don't really like all too much is Knight of Heavenly Thundering Lady, and she has the ability Act on Rearguard Circle, cost Soulblast 2, and until the end of turn, the power increase of trigger effects revealed by your drive check gets power plus 5k. So triggers power go from 10 to 15 for that particular turn. Now, if you're lucky and you have twin drive and you hit two triggers, that's 10k power you generate. If you have triple drive with Hex Orb, that could potentially be 15k power. But my problem is, Soulblast 2 doesn't justify that, and on top of that, you need to pay it in advance before you even know if you're going to hit triggers. Yes, with Sorcerers you can set it up, but you probably cannot set up for your twin drive or your entire triple drive. So yeah, for me this is a hard pass, as I don't like this particular skill, and I think you can get way more value out of your soul with other effects within Keter Sanctuary. Now, another great one which is interesting, and I had high hopes for it, and it can see potential, but I think it's too limited to be as good as we hope it to be, which is Additional Angel, which has the ability Act on Rearguard Circle, cost Soulblast 1, put this unit into your damage zone, choose a face-up grade 3 card from your damage zone, and call to the Rearguard Circle. Now, this is damage zone manipulation, which is actually really good, because it basically turns your damage zone into a second hand, and we love to see more skills like this, as it opens up more synergies and more options and more consistency for respective builds. But my problem with this card is that it can only get Great Freeze, which is a very limited card pool. Yes, in Keter Sanctuary, most of the cards are going to be Great Free, but because it can only get Great Free, the type of combo potential in the future, if we go away from Bastion's main gimmick, which are Great Freeze, then this card is going to be less and less impactful, and therefore I personally can only give it 2 cards, because even right now, the amount of synergies there are, what type of plays you can do, it's kind of limited, and you don't really even want to play this in Bastion, because it's a great one, and you much rather just want to play Great Freeze in Bastion for its consistency. So there's this caveat with this card, where it wants to support Bastion, but by running it, you're not really supporting Bastion, which makes it a bit too awkward in my opinion. Now, another card which is also really awkward is this grade 2, Divine Sister Petite 4, which has the ability Continuous on Guardian Circle. If you have 3 or more grade 4 units, this unit gets shield plus 5k. So it's a 10k shield, which can be an interceptor or can be played from hand because it's a grade 2. The problem is, it screams Bastion support, but you don't really want to play it in Bastion because it's a grade 2. And even if you want to play this in Bastion, we have the grade 3, which is actual analyst Kokobiel. And if you're going to use her in the same situation where you're going to use this card, they both are 10k shield. But Kokobiel can become more, and it's a grade 3, which synergizes way better with Bastion. And in a non-Bastion build, it's not that likely that you will have that many grade 3s always on the field to get the value of this particular card. So for me, this is going to be a 1-star, as it just doesn't really feel like it belongs to any build within Keter's Sanctuary right now. Now, another grade 2, which is also once again a bit underwhelming, is Stellar Razor Angel, which is a double R with the ability Auto Rigor Circle. When this unit attacks, if your damage zone has no face-up cards, this unit gets power plus 5k until the end of battle. It's a restrictive 15k attacker, which is fine, but the restriction is kind of annoying, and for the lack of grade 2s, I wish it did a bit more to compensate for that, but sadly that's not the case. So for me, it's going to be a 2-star card. Yes, it makes good numbers as it gets that 5k power, but it's still a bit annoying if I'm going to be very honest. Now, with the generic support out of the way, let's take a look at this new ride line for Keter's Sanctuary with the encounter cards. And we start off with the grade 0 for the blaster archetype, which of course Vol Bow, and it has the generic starter skill auto when this unit is rode upon. If you went second, draw a card. It's going to be a 1-star card because it's just generic starter and it doesn't really fulfill any extra purpose. Now, if we move up to the grade 1, we see Blaster Javelin, and Javelin has the ability auto when this unit is rode upon by Blaster Dark, reveal the top card of your deck, call to the rearguard circle as rest if it's a unit card, and discard it if it isn't. So effectively it's a 3+1, which is great because, as we're going to see in a second, we immediately going to use that 3+, so you don't really mind if it's at rest, as you're still going to generate value off it, which is great. And it also has the ability continues on rearguard circle during your turn. If you have a Vanguard with Blaster in its card name, this unit gets power plus 2k. So it's a 10k attack or a booster, which is fine. It's not the greatest, but it's what we came to expect. It's its first ability, which is really good. So overall, I'm going to give it a 3-star card. Like, 3+1 is nice. Sadly, there is potential where you're going to call your own triggers, maybe your over trigger or PGs, which isn't that ideal, but it gets the job done, which therefore it's for me a solid 3-star card for the ride line. To make sense of that ability, let's take a look at the grade 2 of the ride line, which is of course Blaster Dark. And Blaster Dark has the ability auto when a unit is placed on the Vanguard Circle rearguard circle, cost count plus 1 and retire another rearguard. Choose one of your opponent's rearguards, retire it, and this unit gets drive plus 1 until the end of turn. So for one counterblast, you trade a 1-for-1 with your opponent, and then you get an extra drive check on your Vanguard circle because you can do the extra drive check. Now, I've explained this before when the card was initially revealed. You get the drive check added to the unit even as a rearguard unit, but as a rearguard, once you attack, you don't perform those drive checks unless you give the unit the ability to perform those drive checks. Let's say, for example, with the Keter's Sanctuary over-trigger. Now, overall, this skill is actually really good, and it synergizes nicely with Blaster Javelin, because if you're right on top of Blaster Javelin, you get that 3+, and now you can sec that unit off immediately, so if it was a trigger or a perfect guard or something that doesn't really do anything, you can immediately turn it into value and snipe one of your opponent's units if you have something on the field, and then get an extra drive check as well, which is great. But on top of that, Blaster Dark also has another effect, which is continues a rearguard circle. During your turn, if your rearguard was retired this turn, this unit gets power plus 5k. So it's a 15k attacker that synergizes with its own ability, or potentially with our Phantom Blaster Dragon, which again is also great. Another thing that interacts with this quite well is Painkiller Angel, as Painkiller Angel retires herself, thus enabling this ability as well. So there are multiple ways how you can interact with this, which is great as it makes more synergistic plays within Keter's Sanctuary. Overall, Blaster Dark is going to, for me, a solid 4-star card. I like both its effects. His first effect is a bit limited to some extent, because in the early game, if you went first, it's less likely that your opponent has a unit, so you don't get the full capacity or the full value of the skill. And as a rearguard unit, gaining the extra drive check doesn't really do anything in most scenarios, thus maybe making the cost a bit overcosted, and it's usually there just to be a 15k beater, and you don't really resolve his first ability besides just once you rode it on the Vanguard Circle. So for that, it's a solid 4-star card that has its ups and downs. Now, moving up to the Grade 3, the big boss of this build, which is of course Phantom Blaster Dragon. And Phantom Blaster Dragon has two effects, from which one is auto. When a unit is placed on the Vanguard Circle, choose a card with Blessed in its card name from your soul, and you may call it to the Vanguard Circle. This is great because it's a 3+1 that you're going to need as you're sacrificing your own units. Now keep in mind, every time that you ride it, you will always call something out from the soul, because if your persona rode it, you could just call it himself out from the soul, as it is also a blaster unit. So every time you're gonna ride it, you will have a unit to call, which is great. That also means you always have that 3+1. The reason why it's so important is because of its secondary effect, which is act on Vanguard Circle once a turn, cost Counter plus 1, and retire 3 rear guards. Choose up to 2 of your opponent's rear guards, retire them, and this unit gets power plus 10k and critical plus 1 until the end of turn. So for 3 retires and a counter plus, you snipe 2 of your opponent and you get that extra power and a crit. Now, with that 3+1 in mind, you basically are trading 2 cards from your hand, or 2 new cards that you need to call to the field, for 2 of your opponent, as a 3+ it just gets negated in that sense. And then for that counter plus, you get the crit and the extra 10k power, which is fine. So overall, Phantom Blaster Dragon is a pretty solid design card, but the thing is, this amount of retire can be very annoying for your opponent to deal with, as we don't really see a lot of consistent retire effects within Overdress right now, and Phantom Blaster Dragon does contain that. And retire is a lot stronger right now because most value engines aren't as effective as we've seen with older eras, so it's going to be an impact at some degree, which makes Phantom Blaster Dragon a pretty solid card. And overall, for me, is going to be a solid 4-star card boss unit. It has the things there to be pretty good, and it gets the support within the set to make it a bit more consistent. My only issue is, however, that how much support are we going to see in the future sets to make this deck last? Because Dragonic Overlord, for example, is pretty generic, so anything in Dragon Empire will probably support Dragonic Overlord to some extent. But Phantom Blaster Dragon heavily relies on retiring your own rearguards. So if we don't get specific support for that playstyle, which doesn't really seem to be the normal thing for Keter's Sanctuary, makes it a bit awkward in the future if it doesn't get support. So for that, it's going to be a 4-star card, as there might be some hiccups later down the line. But luckily, we have some support right now, which can make the deck and the archetype pretty good, which we can see with this great one, Black Sage Chern, which has the ability auto. When a unit is placed on the rearguard circle, if you have a Vanguard with Blaster in its card name, cost, rest this unit, look at the top card of your deck, you may call to the Vanguard Circle if it's a unit card, and at the end of the turn, retire that called unit. Now, what's great about this is that it's a 3+1 when you call it. Sadly, this doesn't interact well with Blaster Javelin, because you need to rest it for the cost, and Blaster Javelin already calls it in rest. So that's an issue here. But besides that, works wonders with whatever card you're playing. But the thing about this card is that you can get a 3+ off of it, but if you see a trigger on top, you could just leave it there. You're not forced to call it. So it's also somewhat of a deck manipulation tool. And yes, you need to rest Charon, thus you're not able to boost with it, but you don't really care for it because you're gonna retire with Phantom Blaster Dragon anyway, so you don't really lose out on the value, and the fact that this is a 7k body also don't really matter as much. So with it all in mind, I think Charon is a solid 4-star card. It's a 3+, while at the same time also deck manipulate, which is kind of crazy. So yeah, really good card. Now on top of that, we also have a new Grade 2, which is Darkness Maiden Maka for the encounter cards, and her ability is auto. When a unit is placed on a rearguard circle, if you have a Vanguard with Blaster in its card name, this unit gets power plus 5k until the end of turn, then cost soulless 1 and retire another rearguard. Look at the 5 cards on the top of your deck, choose up to 1 Grade 1 or less unit card from among them, call to the rearguard circle, and shuffle your deck. So it's a 15k beater in the blaster archetype, which is nice, and then on top of that, it can turn any unit on the field in potentially a new Grade 1 or Grade 0. Now this is basically a way to get consistent access to all your various Grade 1s. We already saw Charon, which is an amazing card, because if we sacrifice a Grade 2 and it can call a Charon, that Charon can immediately call another unit, thus basically chaining off a field that we can then sacrifice for Phantom Blaster Dragon. But we have a couple of other solid Grade 1 targets that we want to hit, and what Maka basically is doing here is giving the blaster archetype an higher consistency to the entire Grade 1 lineup. We can run some 1-offs and 2-offs, and Maka will increase the consistency of actually getting to those cards, because she can check the top 5 and grabbed whatever grade 1 or grade 0 from there, which is actually really, really solid. So with it in mind, I think Maka once again is also a 4-star card. It's really good. The 15k beater on top of it for free is good to make good magic numbers, but then being able to search out our grade 1s, which are so pivotal for this archetype, is really, really great. Besides the encounter cards, we see two new support cards as well for this archetype, from which one is also a grade 1, which is Witch of Entertainment, Brana. And Brana has the ability, continues a rigor circle, if you have a Vanguard with Blaster in its card name, when this unit would be retired for your card's cost, you may retire it as two rearguards. So it's a double retire, which is somewhat similar as Charon can call a card, but this is always going to be a double retire, which is great. And this then in itself makes Maka also a lot better, as it now means we have two different grid ones, which are really good hits on her particular skill. So with it in mind, I think Brana is a solid 3-star card. Like, it doesn't really do anything fancy, it's just a double retire, but for what it does, it's good enough. Now the other direct support card is this grade 3 Wieland's Dragon, and Wieland's Dragon has the ability, auto, when this unit is retired for your card's cost, counter plus 1 and soul plus 1, all of your units with Blaster in its card name get power plus 5k until the end of turn. So this can give your entire field a power buff, which can be nice, but my issue with this card in particular is that it's kind of overcosted and at the same time really awkward. If you're going to use this in combination with Phantom Blaster Dragon, The maximum value you're going to generate off of this card is 20k power, because if you sacrifice this plus the grade 1 that we just talked about that counts as double, you have 4 potential rearguard spots left that are untouched. If all of those rearguards are happen to be blaster cards, then you give 20k power to the field. Even then, it doesn't really feel that great, and that's the ideal situation. In probably most cases, you're just going to generate just 10k power and that's it, which honestly doesn't feel that good. And yes, you might be able to use this off of Blaster Dark's ability, and then you have potentially 5 rearguards or 5 units on the field with Blaster, but that means that you're not activating Phantom Blaster Dragon, which means you don't get the 2 retire, you don't get the 10k power on the Vanguard and the critical, which feels to me like a way less impactful turn than if you just use Phantom Blaster Dragon's skill in the first place. So Wieland's Dragon, it doesn't really feel it, and it doesn't really do it for me, so I'm just going to give it a 1-star, as it feels too awkward in the build it was designed for, and it cannot be played outside of that build, so yeah, not really that great. Now, there is one more support card, which is actually generic support, but it's surprisingly well for the Blaster build, which is this grade 2 Knight of Heavenly Collapse, Copaldo. And Copaldo has the ability, although when this unit is placed on the rearguard circle, from hand, cost, counter plus 1, and rest another rearguard, reveal the top card of your deck and put it into your hand if it's an order card or a grade 3, and call to the rearguard circle if it isn't. So effectively in the Blaster build, where you're probably not going to play order cards, it's call one unit to the field or get your persona right to hand, which is also really, really important. This is great because it, yes, it needs to rest one of your other rearguards, but keep in mind, we're sacrificing our own card, so we can immediately retire that rested unit, so we don't have the negative downside of that particular cost. So it's just a counterless one to call something or add a card from hand, which is actually really good value. So for me, this is going to be a solid 3-star card, as it works nicely for the Phantom Blaster build. It can work for the sorceress because we can manipulate the top deck, so we can dictate more the outcome of the value. And in Bastion, because you get the great freeze to hand, it might be able to work with as well, because it's always going to be a plus. But in Bastion, it feels a bit too awkward because it's a great tool and not really a great free. So yeah, it's a bit iffy in the other builds, but for Phantom Blaster Dragon, it feels like a perfect match made in heaven. Now, of course, we also have a lot of Bastion support with a whole slew of new Great Frees, and we start off with this Great Free, Heavenly Blade of Magnificence, Bestida. And Bestida has the ability, auto, when this card is discarded from your hand during your turn, cost counter plus 2, and soul plus 1, you choose a column, and your opponent puts all of their rearguards in the same column on the bottom of their deck in any order. So this is basically a unit version of the normal order downswing of Sword of Judgment. Now, I don't like this skill a lot because in this particular instance, it's way too overcosted. 2 counter blasts and a soul blast for just those 2 units potentially moving to the bottom, it doesn't really feel that great. And on top of that, it doesn't really do anything else. So It's a bit annoying. Yes, it's synergized with Bastion because it's when it's discarded, but that also means you cannot really call it, and it's yet another card that you cannot put onto the field from your hand, so you're putting more restrictions on yourself. So I'm not really a fan of this card. Maybe some people like because they like the order, but they might think the order is a bit too slow, and this can be used immediately on the first great free turn. But for me, it's going to be 2-star cards. I'm not really a fan of this. Now, another Greed Free, which is interesting, is Heavenly Staff of Kind Intention, Cortez. And Cortez has the ability, auto, when your drive check reveals this card, you may call this card to an open rearguard circle. If you do, this unit gets a boost until the end of turn. So it's a 3+1, but instead of getting to your hand, you call it to the field. It doesn't really mind that, it doesn't really hurt you all too much because Great Frees aren't shield value in the first place, so you don't lose shield value. It does give you a 13k boost, or in Bastion's case a 15k booster, which can be nice if you have still have a column left and you haven't called the unit behind it, or you didn't use Darkstrain Dragon, for example. This is another way to just buff your field a bit, but it feels a bit too sacky and a bit underwhelming, so for that, it's going to be a 2-star card for me. Now, another card that allows you to boost with your Great Freeze is the new Tripwar Great Free, which is Heavenly Bow of End Defying Guidance. Reverus has the ability Continuous Rearguard Circle. If your Persona rode this turn, this unit gets boost. Which is fine, I don't really like these particular skills, it's not consistent, but if you know you can Persona ride, you can move it to the back, so there's that. And then it has the ability Auto from Back Row Rearguard Circle once a turn. When your other unit stands by a card's effect, stand this unit. So it allows you to reset the entire column with Bastion, which can be fine. You can also maybe use this in the Sorcerer's build because we have the Great Free that restands when you drive like a trigger, so that's synergized as well. But you lose out on the 4k power, which lowers the magic number of power that you generate, so I don't really think it's worth it in that variant. But overall, even in Bastion, it feels a bit too underwhelming because you still are reliant on the fact that you need a Persona Rod. You can combine this with Darkstrain Dragon that just gives this unit the boost, so in turns where you don't Persona Rod, it has to boost via that, so you still get the value. But is that good enough? It's a bit iffy in my opinion, but overall I can see the value behind it, so I'm gonna give it a 3-star card because unlike the previous Grade 2, there are inherent synergies where this card does be able to circumvent his Persona Ride restriction. Now, another Great Free, which is a controversial one because personally I'm not too much a fan of it, but I've seen a lot of buzz around this particular card, which is Heavenly Flight Dragon, Prideful Dragon. And this particular Great Free has the ability Auto Rearguard Circle. When this unit attacks, if you have 4 or more Great Free rear guards, cost counterblast 1, soul blast 1, and draw a card. If your Persona rode this turn, you may have this unit get power plus 5k and critical plus 1 until the end of turn instead of drawing a card. So this card does one of two things. Either it draws a card for a counterblast soul blast, or it gains 5k power on a critical. Either way, they're bad outcomes. For a counterblast soul blast, they're not really good value. I'm gonna say that straight up, it's not good value. And the fact that you need to get the restriction that you need 4 or more rear guards is also kind of annoying. Yes, Bastion can just plot down a lot of Great Frees, no problem, as they all have Great Frees, so that shouldn't be the biggest issue. But if you don't have the Darkstrain Dragon, calling all those Great Frees don't really do anything because the ones in the back row probably cannot boost. Now, if we can Persona Ride this turn, we get in the argument where players are saying this card is insane because we have a double crit unit that can restand and potentially then swing for triple crit because you can pay for the cost again. I still think the cost is a bit overcosted for Countless Soul Blast. Then if you go for triple crit, you need to pay 2 Countless, 2 Soul Blast. Yes, you have Facade, but Facade is still behind it on hit skill, so you cannot guarantee the value of it. You cannot just say that this cost is negated because of Facade, because if you don't see Facade, you're screwed. And if you do see Facade, but your opponent can easily guard against it, you're again kind of screwed here. So I'm a bit iffy, and then on top of that, even if we go for the most optimal outcome, it's still behind the fact that we need the Persona Ride, which isn't a consistent thing to do. So we have a Great Free that just sits there that doesn't really do anything unless you Persona Ride. As no way you're gonna use this skill to just draw a card. That's kind of underwhelming in Bastion, because what you're going to draw is just another Great Free that has no shield value unless you draw a trigger, which you might not also want to do. So yeah, for me, I know a lot of people are kind of excited about this card, and I know some people will give it a 4 or 5 star rating. I'm gonna go down and just say it's a 3 star card. I can see the potential in particular instances, but it's not amazing. I'm very much in the ballpark to just say it's a 2 star card, but I know there are so many people out there that are saying it's a really good card, whereas I'm a bit skeptical about the thing. Now, another card which also sparked up a lot of conversation, but in this case I'm on the side of the people that are saying the card is really good, which is Form Up O Chosen Knight, a grade 3 normal order, which is 100% made for Bastion because he's on the damn artwork. And we see the ability, play this with cost, count plus one, and soul plus one. So once again, the same cost as Prideful Dragon. But what do we get in this case? We get, perform all the effects below according to the number of grade 3 units. Two or more, choose one of your units and it gets power plus 5k until the end of turn. So more power, which is great because power columns might be sometimes an issue for Bastion. Three or more, draw a card. So, in most instances, this is what you're going to get. You draw a card and you give 5k power. Keep in mind, Prideful Dragon in this particular instance just gives you the draw for the same cost. Whereas you don't get the power. Now, true, in this case, it's an order card, so you need to discard the order, so you minus one. So, you might say Prideful Dragon is still a bit better. But, then we get four or more, and this is the same condition as Prideful Dragon. Choose one of your vanguards and it gets drive plus one until the end of turn. So we then negate the minus, but on top of that, it's a drive check on our vanguard, which gives even more pressure because it means higher consistency of hitting a trigger or potentially the over trigger, or also increase the consistency of hitting a grade 3. You might think to yourself, why do you need to increase the consistency of that? I have seen Bastion players drive checking double perfect guard, or they play the grade 2 as a 2 of or 3 of and they double hit that thing, or they hit double trigger and no grade 3. It happens. This extra drive check can negate that instance a little bit more, so it's less likely to appear. So overall, with that in mind, I think it's a solid 4 star order. Like, it's not an over amazing order because in terms of value that you're generating, you're just breaking even because you discard one but you draw a card, so you negate that cost. You soul blast one, which is somewhat equal to 5k power, and then you counter blast one, which is then equal to the extra drive check. So in terms of value you're generating, it's okay. The good part about this card is that it's a lot of different skills in one card. So you get a lot of stuff in one particular instance. So you don't have to draw multiple cards to get this, where usually you would have a one unit that gives you a drive check, another unit that gives power, and then another unit that draws you a card. In this case, it's all within one card, so that adds up on this particular card. So that's why I think it's a solid 4-star card for Bastion. Now we have one more card that's specific Bastion support, and in this case that's a grade 3 Blitz order in the likes of Sublime Will. And Sublime Will has the ability, if you have 3 or more grade 3 units, which you probably always gonna have, choose one of your vanguards and it gets power plus 20k until the end of the battle. 20k shield in a grade 3. That's a lot better than Coca BL. So yeah, this card is really good and potentially replaces Coca BL. This is really great. The only thing that Coca BL has over this card is that you can use multiple Coca BLs in one turn, as you can only use one order per turn. So it's a bit of pick and choose, and because of that, I'm gonna give it a 4-star rating. 20k shield is really good. We already talked about how good it is with the front trigger. Now being able to have that in another card for Bastion, which is also a grade 3, is really good. Now, of course, we know Keter Sanctuary is the Bastion show, but we had some sorceress support cards, and these Hexaorb sorceress support cards are actually really good. Because first up, we got this grade 1 Diaglass sorceress, and she has the ability, although when this unit is placed in a regular circle from hand, if your vanguard is Hexaorb sorceress or Pentagleam sorceress, cost counterblast 1 and discard a card from your hand, look the two cards from the top of your deck, choose up to 2 unit cards from among them, call them to the graveyard circle, and put the rest on the top of your deck in any order. So we can manipulate the top 2, but instead of putting them on the bottom of the deck, we can call them to the field. This might not sound all too amazing, because if you see 2 triggers, you're kind of screwed because you just wasted 1 card from hand and the counter lasts for nothing, but there is more to this card than just that. Keep in mind, we have other cards that can manipulate the top of our deck. And sometimes we see a non-trigger or a card that we cannot really use right now, so we want to put it on the bottom of the deck. But now we can just say we keep them at the top because now we can collision immediately to the field, thus conserving our hand for potentially guarding or keep cards that we want to use for combo potential later on, and then just pressure our opponent with other cards that are top of our deck. This is really good to just apply more pressure, which the Sorcerer's deck really lacks at the current stage. But a more important thing is that if you combine this with the unride skill of Pentagleam Sorceress, so when you ride Hexaorb Sorceress on top of Pentagleam, you can see the top three and change those three in a different order. So if you see two normal units, you can put those two on the top of the deck, then use this grade one and immediately call those two units to the field, and you know what you're going to get out of this value. So then it's a completely different story, as we're not going in half blind, as now we know what we're going to get, and these are specific windows of opportunity where this card gets ridiculously insane. So I think this is a very powerful card. Being able to turn those deck manipulation into actual pluses on the field is really awesome, and it opens up more lines of plays for the Hexaorb Sorcerer's build. So with it in mind, I think it's a solid 4-star card. It's not a 100% go-to strat, but its usage in particular instance makes this card kind of ridiculous. So for that, it's going to be a solid 4-star card for me. Now, another really great support card for Hexaorb Sorcerers is a grade 2. And yes, I know grade 2s are very rare in Keter Sanctuary, and usually they're very underwhelming. But in this case, this grade 2 makes up for that, as we got Knight of Subtlety, Owine. And Owine has the ability, although when is unit displaced on the rearguard circle, if your Vanguard is Hexaorb Sorceress, cost count Soul Blast 1, look the two cards from the top of your deck, choose up the two cards from among them, put them on the top of your deck in any order, and put the rest on the bottom of the deck in any order. So in this case, we can manipulate the top two again, but now we have the potential of putting them both on the bottom of the deck. This is a lot better than the grade one from the previous set, which forces you to put one at the top and one on the bottom. Now we are able to put both on the bottom of the deck if they're really bad. But this is another card that works really well with the grade one source that we just talked about. Because if we see two non-trigger units and two units that are actually really good, maybe a grade three and a grade one, because this card's already on the field, we can use that grade one, superior call those units to the field, and now we can drive check the cards that are underneath without putting those cards on the bottom of the deck. Another way to up the consistency and the value of our particular units. But on top of that, Owine has another effect, which might look really bad, but if you look at the interactions within the Sorcerer's deck, it's kind of nutty, which is, on a rearguard circle, when your drive check reveals a trigger unit, cost counterblast 1, and this unit gets power plus 10k until the end of turn. So every time you drive check a unit, you can counter plus 1 and plus 10k power. You might think to yourself, now hold on a moment, you don't like counter plus 1 for power, and how do you, so why do you like this one, which is RNG related because you need to drive check a trigger? The reason why I like this is because of how Hexaorb Sorcerers works. If you hit a trigger with Hexaorb Sorcerers, you give 10k power to a unit because of the trigger, then Sorceress gives you another 10k power to the unit, and then if you want to, you can activate this grade 2 to counter one and give another 10k power to this unit. So one trigger then suddenly gives 30k power out of nowhere, and if you hit multiple triggers, you can give 10, 10, 10, 10, 10, 10, 10, 10, and keep going and going, and suddenly your numbers are through the roof, and you start hitting as a truck, which is basically what Sorceress needs. So this is a very flexible card that opens up a lot of synergies, more deck manipulation, and a lot of power. So for that, I think it's a solid 4-star card, which opens up more options for Hexaorb Sorcerers and makes the deck look a lot more solid than it did straight out set 1. And then finally we got a new grade 3, which is kind of interesting as it opens up a different strategy pattern, but feels a bit less impactful like the other two cards, as we got Octa Devote Sorceress, which has the ability Auto Rigor Circle. When your drive check reveals a trigger unit, if your Vanguard is Hexaorb Sorceress, cause retire this unit and count charge 1 or soul charge 1. So it's a resource engine for a minus, which can be okay, because you go fast for your resource, as we just saw with both units and even with the older support, so getting something like this can be great. But that isn't the main selling point about this card in particular, because there is a combo that we can do with the grade 3 that we already talked at somewhere in the middle of this video, because remember the grade 3 that once it drive checks, you can call to an open rearguard circle and then can boost. If you combine it with this grade 3, you can actually turn that unit into a multi-attacker, because if you drive check a trigger and you retire this unit, you have an open front row circle, and then you can call that grade 3 if you drive check it immediately afterwards to that same circle that just opened up because of this grade 3, and thus you have a multi-attack engine. Now you might think to yourself, how are you supposed to set this up? Well, there are a couple of ways that you can do this. If you see in the top three of your deck that particular grade three and a trigger with your on-ride skill of Pentagleam Sorceress, you can just stack it accordingly and just be gone from that point onward. You can potentially also see top two cards with the other grade two that we just talked about that can also potentially set this up, so there's another option in that. But another way that we can do this is that if we see that particular grade three in the top cards of our deck, we can stack it at the top. That if we Persona Rode with Hexaorb Sorceress, then we can use our Persona Ride ability to put a trigger on top of that grade three, and now we once again set up the combo as we can drive check the trigger first, retire this sorceress, and then drive check the grade three, which then can be called to that particular circle, which is great. And if you think, now how is that grade three supposed to hit for solid numbers? If there was a booster behind it, we can give that booster the extra 10k power off the trigger, or the 10k power off of Hexaorb Sorceress herself, thus making the new attack that comes out of nowhere a lot stronger and still be able to hit over potential defensive triggers, thus opening up another strategy for Hexaorb Sorceress, which is kind of neat. So with it all in mind, I think it's a solid 3-star card, like, for the resource engine, what it's supposed to be supporting, it's okay, but it opens up that extra line of play, which is kind of interesting, which ups the value of this card, in my opinion, a bit, thus granting it a 3-star card as it is. And with that, we talked about all the cards for Keter's Sanctuary. As I said at the beginning of the video, we got a lot of support for Bastion and a bit support for Sorceress and the new archetype for the Ride Line from Phantom Blaster Dragon with the whole encounter cards. And they do bring a lot of new interesting dynamics to the respective builds. Like, Bastion is doing Bastion builds. Overall, it doesn't change all too much. It's got a couple of tools here and there, bit higher shield value, maybe a bit more drive checks to increase the consistency, but it doesn't change things up all too much. Whereas Phantom Blaster Dragon brings a whole new playstyle to Keter's Sanctuary, which we were expecting with the whole self-retire stuff, as it looks pretty solid on paper, and I hope it's getting a bit more support to make it more spicy with set 3 and set 4. But I think the biggest surprise out of this set, even though it only got two to three support cards, is the Sorceress build. Those grade 1, grade 2, and to some extent the grade 3 do a lot of work for the deck and opens up a lot more lines of play, a big higher consistency to the deck, and I think it's going to be in a way better spot than it was in set 1. At the very least, it feels like this support for Sorceress was a lot better at a higher value rate than what we saw for the two cards that Eugene got for Dragon Empire. So hopefully we see a bit more love for these secondary archetypes for the respective nation, because honestly, the Sorceress build feels way more fun and a lot more interesting than Bastion. Bastion, I'm not gonna lie, probably a lot of players know it, it feels heavily Oonga Boonga strats and just really bored, and I'm just really tired of that particular playstyle. So I hope we're going to see more awesome support like Sorceress, or who knows, maybe some more interesting stuff in set 3. We already know that we get Derpy Maelstrom and we get Mafia Boss Dragon and whatnot, so let's see what set 3 is going to have in store. But of course, this particular set wave got a lot of interesting stuff for the respective build, so let me know in the comments down below which cards you're the most interested for this particular playstyle, which cards are you going to get to upgrade your deck, as there is a lot of spicy new tools to upgrade your particular playstyle or to add new tech cards to your flavor. So let me know all your thoughts in the comments section down below. Of course, don't forget, if you want to cop any cards of this particular set, you can go to parks.com to get your cards with either singles, cases, case splits, or whatnot. And don't forget, if you order on their store, use the discount code TIMELEAP5 to get 5% discount on your entire order to make this quite expensive cardboard hobby a bit more payable and a bit more doable, as every cent we can save goes a long way. But with that said, I'm gonna give also a huge shout out to my Patreon supporters over patreon.com/vanguardinsider. You guys are amazing. If you want to support the channel or everything that's happening on the channel, you can simply go to patreon.com/vanguardinsider and become a Patreon as well. But with that said, I've been Mr. Timeleap, and I see you guys in the next one.